we've seen evidence of poll workers telling voters, oh, never mind that paper, that's just for the central office or administrative. It requires people in a ballot in which they may have 100 different races or more, judicial races, congressional races, ballot initiatives, to be able to track how they voted and then go back at the very end on what looks like a little cash register tape. And the academic studies show that people, even if they're being very careful, may not notice if the receipt, the paper record, is different than the way they cast their ballot. I think it's better to just scrap that system and go to a paper ballot. One other thing I should say is that a touchscreen machine is not required under the Help America Vote Act for disabled access. There is a system that allows a voter to use a computer on the front end with whatever assistive technology is available, but it produces a printed optical scan ballot. So there is no requirement that there be any touchscreen used any place in the country. It's only one of the potential solutions for disabled voters.
How are you both preparing for this, what seems like a vast increase in the number of voters come November, if these primaries and caucuses are any indication?
Well, you know, you're right. It's been fascinating to watch. You know, this has been the most participatory nominating process in the history of our country, by far. We've had over 48 million votes cast in both of the races, and we just have never seen that before.
Are we talking something like triple the number in the past?
Well, I don't know what the national figure is, and we're not done yet. But the point is, in the past, parties could select their candidates however they wanted. Sometimes they were caucuses. Sometimes they were just backroom deals. Today, people are out there voting, and so the enthusiasm and excitement about it is like we've never seen before. In my state, we could get upwards of over 70% of the vote. Some secretaries are talking about 80%. That's a strain on just the sort of mechanical system on election day. So I think there are lots of things we're all doing to prepare. One of the things we're focused on in Missouri is not only this, make sure we don't run out of ballots because then folks have to stand in line a long time, but also preparing poll workers. You know, elections don't just happen. They happen because citizens get involved and they go work as election judges on election day. So I hope you talk to your viewers about getting out there and volunteering to be election
judges.
How do
people?
Well, it varies by state. You know, that's one of the things about our democracy in America is it's very localized. Elections are run locally, not even by us. We don't run elections in our states. I have 116 election authorities in my state and thousands of poll workers who are on the front lines, and those are regular people. And so we need to get people to volunteer with their local election authority to say, count me in. I want to help on election day.
Overall, in the industrialized world, the United States is at the bottom end of voter participation. I mean, we're still only talking about little more than half of people voting. How do you push for guarantee universal voting? The discussion, for example, of Puerto Rico, the idea that they have a holiday on election day. They don't do it on a Sunday or any day that might be a religious day for someone, but on a Tuesday, when they have one of the highest rates of voting in this country. Secretary Bowen.
Both of us would support a national holiday, but that's really only part of it. I think one of the things I'm seeing in California is voters saying to me, you know, I'd stop voting because I wasn't confident that it mattered. And we really need to assure people that if they take the time to register, their names will be on the rolls. And the role of voter registration in this process is, I think, often neglected. You can do a lot to interfere with people's right to vote by mishandling the voter registration rolls. And then we need to make all of this transparent so that people have confidence that there is a way to audit, there's a way to check that every vote is counted as it was cast, and that the system has integrity.
But what about the obstacles to voting? For example, if someone becomes an immigrant, why aren't they that day an automatic voter?
Well, I would support that. I mean, I think that's what the direction we should move. And if we do that and we begin to track people from the very first time they're eligible to vote, we'll have a lot less concern about dead wood on the rolls and what happens when people move, because we'll know where they were from the beginning of their voting history.
You mean a national voter database?
Well, it's state run, and right now we're not ready to move to a national database. I think we have to be careful. We don't know what the integrity of the voter registration databases is in other states, and we want to be very careful about removing someone from the poll, from the registration database. But in California, I think we've done a lot to make it easier for people to vote. California voters have the right to be a permanent vote-by-mail voter. They can elect to get their ballot in the mail without taking any extra step in every election cycle. And we now have 41% of people choosing to vote by mail. Over 60% get their ballots automatically that way in some counties.
What about former felons? What are the rules around felony disenfranchisement here in California?
That varies from state to state, too. Here it's automatic, but that doesn't mean that people who are former felons know they have the right.
Meaning when they're finished with probation, parole, they can vote.
Right. We do have some sheriffs who've been very proactive about this. Sheriff Lee Baca in Los Angeles County, which is the biggest county in California, of course, has a program in his jail system to get people registered before they're released. He wants to cut recidivism. And one of the ways you do that is by giving people a stake in society. So I've seen some very innovative things. But we often in our system of innovation don't go from something great that's happening in a local or state jurisdiction to let's all work.
Secretary Carnahan, for felony disenfranchisement, the issue in Missouri?
It's automatic.
Automatically.
Just as in California.
But
so
people don't know.
Once you're finished, you can vote.
And what about universal voting? What do you think would lead toward that?
Well, look, people have to take some responsibility in this, and you can't force someone. As you key, you know, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. It's the same way with elections, but we can make it easier. And part of it is making it convenient for people, and part of it is making sure they're confident in the process. You know, one of the things I like to remind people about is just even Election Day. You know, why is it we vote on the first Tuesday after the first Monday in November? It's because of history. When this was established by Congress in 1845, we were an agrarian country. They didn't do it in the spring because farmers were planting. In the summer, they had growing season. In the fall, it was harvest season. So they chose November because it was convenient. And they chose Tuesday because it was convenient. It wasn't a day where people were going to church. It might take a long time on your horse and buggy to get into town to vote. And Wednesday was market day. So Tuesday was convenient. So we're stuck here with this thing that was convenient in 1845. I think we ought to try to make it convenient and relevant today, and I think more people would vote.
And what about making it possible for, at every step of the way, for example, immigrants, when they become a citizen, they immediately vote?
You know, I've been to citizenship ceremonies and participated in those in my state, and the League of Women Voters is always right outside the door. And whenever I talk about it, the number one thing I talk about is, now that you're a citizen, one of your responsibilities is to vote, and there's a long line out there with people signing up to vote, and I think that's great.
Why did you both become secretaries of state? And I don't think people even think about their state secretaries of state. You come from a distinguished political family. Secretary Carnahan, your father, the senator and governor of Missouri, your mother, first female senator of Missouri, grandfather,
He was a member of Congress a long time ago.
And an ambassador
yes.
in Africa, right. in Sierra Leone.
Right. So my mother always jokes it as sort of a genetic defect. But when I was a kid, public policy and what you did in your community was what we talked about at the dinner table. And so I grew up thinking you could make a difference and have enjoyed serving as Secretary of State because I think you can make a difference. We can talk about these issues, about voting and other things we do to make government work well, and I love that.
Well, we're going to have to leave it there, so another day we'll find out, Secretary Bowen, why you became Secretary of State, but I thank you both very much for being with us, and I also thank the PBS station here in San Diego, KPBS, for being so gracious today, Carla Connor and Ina Newell and all the team here for making it possible. Also want to thank Dennis Moynihan, all the folks back in New York. Tonight we'll be going to Vermont. Tomorrow we'll be at the borders in Burlington at 2 o'clock in the evening at the Old Labor Hall in Barre, Vermont. On Sunday in Manchester at Northshire Books, and in the evening in Troy, New York. Then back in New York we'll be broadcasting. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us.